guest here this afternoon, Julie Burchill, is with us. Now, listen, when you talk, Julie, people will not believe it's you. So give us something, first of all. Give us a nice sentence.
Hello.
Is this really the acid tongue that we know and love? Really, listen, when I first met you, I didn't believe it was you.
I know, I'm very, very shy and retiring.
Yeah, I mean, most of the stuff you write is kind of vitriolic and has plenty of attack. How do you work that out in your own head, Julie?
Well, even though I seem to be a very nice person and rather a simpering pussycat, I'm really like a psychopath. And, like, when I write my column, all of the nasty bits come out, and that's why I'm so sweet and nice. But I've just had, like, 3 weeks off, and during that time, I just got nastier and nastier, and I've been yelling at my son and my husband every day, and then last night he said I should get out and not come back till I was writing my column again, because like I've become so nasty, disgusting, and like I've got no friends left, but thank God I'm going back to work next week.
I think that tells me everything I've ever wanted to know about you. Would you say that you definitely have two personalities? You're a split personality then?
I'm absolutely split, yeah. There's the nice me and the bad me.
Okay, well, let's get down to some nitty-gritty. First of all, Modern Review. This is your own magazine. Why did you start it and how's it going?
Well, I'm one of the co-founders. There are another two. I have to mention them or I get beaten up when I go home.
Okay.
And we just started it because all the magazines around were rubbish. And, like, there was no magazine which was treating what they call popular culture with, like, both seriousness and was being amusing. You either had to read Smash Hits, which was amusing, but it was, like, stupid. Or you could read, like, The Independent, which was, like, intelligent, I guess, but was so boring. And we thought there must be a way of doing it in a way which is both, like, treating it seriously or as seriously as you want to treat it and still being amusing. And I think that's what it is.
Okay, what are the best and worst newspapers and magazines around at the moment, in your view?
The worst newspaper, I think, is probably The Guardian.
The worst is
yes.
The Guardian. And the best?
The best newspaper is probably The Sun, because it's a work of art. It should be hanging in the Tate with the bricks and everything.
Why?
It's just a work of art. When you look at The Sun, you look at something like Gosha, it's a work of modern art. It's like the same as Wham or all those things Roy Lichtenstein did.
Yeah.
It's pop art.
Let's take a few questions from the posse. Julie Burchill is with us today, and let's take one from Richard. Go ahead.
Well,
for Julie Burchill.
Ask one that maybe you're going to ask a bit later, but you started at the NME in like 77, something like that, as their punk correspondent, because they didn't have a clue what was going on.
That's right.
Do you think the music papers now, the NMEs and Melody Makers, are in touch or are they less in touch?
Oh, they're shocking. I mean, when I went to the NME, I probably shouldn't say this, but that was like 1977, and it was like a non-stop 24-hour bacchanalian orgy. And it was like people passing out unconscious everywhere, and you'd have to walk over them, and like it was a way of life, and there was fights, and people savaged people and mutilated them. And it was like punk was in the NME. It was alive with the spirit of the place. We had to be like forcibly restrained at times from killing each other. But like in about 1979, when all that stopped, suddenly, like overnight, it became like an insurance office again, which it had been before, and I believe still is that way.
You're on form today. We're coming back with Julie Burchill in just a second. Stay right there, Julie Burchill. FM in the afternoon. This is Steve Wright in the afternoon, and Julie Burchill is here.
Yay!
Okay, now what are you laughing at, Julie? Please.
It's just like all my friends listen to this. I'm gonna be really embarrassed.
Why?
Because like I don't know. Because like, it's like this program. If you're on it, like everyone listens to you, and like all the other things I do, no one listens to them.
This is where you can really make your mark now. Listen, are you really earning like 120 grand a year or something like that?
That's my basic. There's perks.
So what do you get? London waiting? LVs?
Leisure bachelors, yeah.
You serious?
So, babysitting, yeah, that type
so
of thing.
When you started out in the early 70s, did you ever think that you would be this rich?
The NME, which like it's like this big bastion of socialism, had this really disgusting system where they knew young kids were desperate to write for them, and they would exploit this like, you know, South African gold miner owners or something. And they recruited all these teenagers and would pay them like below the NUJ minimum, but they didn't belong to the union, so that was okay. And when I started there, I literally had to take bottles back to the shops every morning to get my bus fare to work.
Get
I mean,
the
in these
back.
Days, like no deposit, no return, I would be to get to work. You know?
So you owe your whole career to R. Whites?
Exactly. I mean, it was shocking.
Let's talk about your newest second novel, in fact. So you're a novelist now, right? So this is the second one, and it's called No Exit.
Yeah.
So tell us a bit about it.
It's about a young hack from a tabloid newspaper who goes to Prague as a foreign correspondent and has like lots of explosive, exotic sex there, and then like comes back again.
Oh my God. So down the arse now. Mikey has a question for Julie. Burchill is here today.
What were you like at school? You must have been the school rebel. You must have been the school outcast.
I was unbearable. And I was actually asked to stop going to school. What do they call it now? Dislocated.
Yeah. Expelled.
No, there's a new word for it. I was like asked not to go anymore when I attacked a teacher with a chair.
Let's move on to some really serious stuff, Julie, because I did want to discuss this, and I know you don't want this brought up, but who is your favourite member of Take That?
Mark.
Yeah. I knew it.
I know, it's really predictable.
Yeah, Jason's your favourite, isn't
Jason
it?
Jason Orange is my favourite.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
All the boys like Jason.
Because he's hard.
He's a hard guy.
He's hard as he looks.
Kind of Ken of Take That. He's like the bloke out of Bros who, you know, disappeared. Yeah. Jason Orange is just in the background there. Keeps himself to himself.
As somebody who was there on the cutting edge of music in the 70s, I mean, what do you think of it now? I mean,
I think Take That are better than the Sex Pistols.
Well, that is, I mean, it's a very provocative thing to say.
That's upset Richard.
You can't be saying, I mean, you're just saying that.
No, I'm not. Looking back, if I could completely wipe out and expurgate my involvement with punk, I would do it. I'm
why?
So shamefully embarrassed of the whole thing.
Yes, but why?
Because I hate the music. I can't believe the dumb things people said. I can't believe the way we thought we were changing anything when you look at the music business now. And it was all just so futile. And I think everybody who was involved in it, it's like only people who weren't involved with punk look back on it nostalgically. Everyone who was there thinks, oh my God.
Okay, Nikki has a question here for Julie. Burchill is here with us today.
If you were going, I know you've just had 3 weeks holiday and you obviously don't want any more, but if you were going away and you could take somebody else's novel with you or another article by another writer, who would it be?
It'd be a novel by Jeanette Winterson about a lot of lesbians in love.
Right.
Is the fact that they're ugly of significant or not?
But it seems to make it's more literature. If you've got a bunch of beautiful lesbians in love, it's porn, and if they're ugly, it's literature.
Julie Burchill is with us. We'll be right back in just a moment. Yeah. Julie Burchill is here. You know, Michael Bolton's not a bad singer, and he looks good. What are they thinking of doing this song? This is boring and sterile. This is awful. It's just cack. It really is awful. Take it off, please, for goodness sake.
I watched the woman at number 27 get undressed with my telescope. Why she has my telescope, I do not know.
Julie Burchill is here. It's 10 minutes to 5. Go back to Julie in just a second. Fraud in Britain costs £468 million a year to the authorities. Bald men under 55 are more likely to get heart attacks, says a new US report, but not if you look after yourself. Bruce Willis has taken on extra bodyguards after death threats.
People who say I used to like their early stuff,
yeah,
but don't like them so much now.
Yes.
Easy life.
Here we go.
A lot of people don't know that it's the primary reason for suicide in the 20th century. You stand there talking to someone about the state of the world music business and you say, well, I'm well into you too at the moment. That new album is The Dogs. And you look at them and you know what they're going to say. You silently beg them not to say those words. You silently scream at them that if they do, you're going to cave their ruddy head in. But you know that they will. These people know so much about music. And then it jumps out, they're useless, yeah, pretentious, mooies. Well, I used to like their early stuff.
Yeah.
Ah! No! You tonkers! I think I'm going to blow my own head off. Easy life!
The throbbing pulse of sound, speed right in the afternoon.
FM in the afternoon. We're back now with Julie Burchill. Yay! I read the other day, Julie, that you described yourself as a coward. In what way are you a coward? Because I think actually you're very brave. I think that some of the stuff you say needs a certain amount of bravery.
Well, I'm a coward because, like, when I write, I'm in my room and I've got, like, 3 locks on the door. But, like, the only time I've been, like, confronted with somebody I wrote something about, it was Claire Rayner. And she came up to me and I was so intimidated by her that she says to me, you wrote this horrible thing about me. And the only thing that came to me I had to say was, no, I didn't. I swear I didn't.
Just deny it.
She says, yes, you did. I squealed and I saw my husband was across the room and I literally ran across the room and I cowered behind him and she was coming towards me. My husband said to her, stop it, don't frighten my wife. And afterwards I looked at myself and I thought, my God, you are pathetic.
But do you ever regret anything that you write? I mean, imagine, like, for example, that instant there. Do you regret what you wrote about?
No, I don't. She shouldn't have tried to bully me like that.
But do you ever sit down at the computer there and think, the copy has gone up to the magazine and you think, my God. What are the consequences going to be of
this? No, I don't think in that way.
You don't?
No, I don't. Because everything I'm saying, I believe it when I'm writing it down. I don't just go, ho, 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 I'm going to wind them all up. If I did feel like that, then I would think sooner or later, oh, it wasn't worth the joke.
Well, I was going to ask you, I mean, how contrived is it?
It's not contrived at all, because I think life is so short and one spends so much time taking stick for things one really believes in, that why, no, who but a fool would make up a bunch of other things they didn't believe in and spend all the rest of their life taking stick for them too? You'd waste all your life doing it.
I wonder why we should care, with greatest of respect, I wonder why we should care what you say. I wonder why people do.
I don't think people should. And like all the nasty reviews and like all the nasty pieces written about me, as long as it's not written by people I know who thought were my friends, I don't give a damn what people I don't know think about me. That's why it amazes me so much when people say to me, but you could hurt people's feelings doing that, because A, they don't know me from Adam, B, they don't respect me, then C, why should they care about my opinion? Doesn't make sense.
I think to myself, well, I mean, I've met you once before and I was amazed at how kind of nice you are and how, you know, how genteel you are. But in the back of my mind is I'm thinking, well, we're getting on okay and she's enjoying the show and we'll say goodbye and everything will be fine, have a coffee and all the rest of it. And then, like, in about 4 weeks' time, Steve Wright, you know, and I'll read some dreadful piece about me and I mean...
But look what happened and look at that wonderful piece my magazine ran on you.
Yeah, I know, but I mean, does that ever happen? I mean, do you ever...
Do I ever go off and stitch people up?
Yeah.
No. Once I've met people and I like them, I can write nothing nasty about them.
We're in the clear, anyway. Now, listen, are you still a shoplifter, Julie?
Certainly not. I'm a married woman.
But you used to be a shoplifter, didn't you?
Only when I was 15. Well, 13 to 15, yeah.
I was going to say, if you could, because Richard, what did you want?
I need a telly, really.
You need a telly, yeah.
I could get you one.
Why do you tell people that you were a shoplifter and that you were a communist, or supposedly a communist?
Because most people who make it in the media come from, like, these really blameless, spotless backgrounds. They've been to either public school, then they go to Oxford, they go to Cambridge, and like there's not a blot on their copybook. And it's depressing to see that all through the years, ever since like the end of the war up to now, meant to be a class of society, it seems to be people like that who keep the whole thing ticking over. And when someone like me comes along who's got like, who was a juvenile delinquent and stuff like that, it's like, I think it's nice and slightly inspirational if there's like any other juvenile delinquents who are like fed up with school, to know that if you do run away from school and if you do get caught shoplifting, it's not the end of your life.
Yeah.
You're not going to be like sent down a salt mine forever, and you can go on and do something else afterwards.
We're going to come back in just a second with Julie Burchill and round off. Julie Burchill is with us today.
The 90s station. One. For the 90s nation. F. The non-stop.
Stop.
Music station. M. Of devastation.
Extending the boundaries and conventions of radio, this is Steve Wright in the afternoon. We make the difference.
FM from the BBC, Julie Burchill is here. It's 5:01 in Warwickshire. Discovery of some wartime explosives has closed a large section of the A444 in the centre of Nuneaton right now. Paranoid man.
They still write to Annie Nightingale with light bulb jokes. Ha 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 ha!
It's another true story.
It's another true story. 1920, a young girl was pulled out of a German canal. She later claimed that she was the Grand Duchess Anastasia, daughter of Nicholas II, the last Tsar of Russia, who was assassinated with his family in 1918. The Tsar and his family had been killed by Russian revolutionaries on the 17th of July, 1918. The bodies were loaded onto a farm cart and taken away to be buried. But there were rumors that one of the bodies, a girl, showed signs of life. Two soldiers smuggled her out of Russia and into Romania. It wasn't until she tried to kill herself 2 years later in the Landwehr Canal in Berlin that the world knew of her survival. nice one. It was a Dewhurst one, wasn't it, that one?
Now, from the money markets of the world, Steve Wright in the afternoon. Financial headlines and share check.
Here is the latest financial news supplied by the BBC's business unit. Share prices are lower in London. The pound currently stands at $1.43.5, down 2 cents. And two marks, 32.3, down 3 and a fifth fenics. In Tokyo, the Nikkei closed down 64 at 16799. In Hong Kong, the Hang Seng closed up 28 at 6178. In New York, the Dow is up 23 at 3346. At home, the FT 100 closed down 1.0 at 2817 exactly. The oil price currently down 5 cents at $18.84 a barrel. Closing shares, BT 406 plus 6, British Gas 289 plus 3, British Airways 285 plus 6, Nat Power 312 minus 2, Power Gen 315 unchanged, and Scottish Power 235 unchanged.
The things people would never say.
Oh yes, just put your feet up, open a couple of cans of beer, and Channel 4's got everything you want on Sundays.
Clap in now. Stomp your feet. Welcome to the club.
The best new dance music for the weekend, carefully selected from sources around the world and road tested to the highest standards, especially for you. Don't we just spoil you? Join me for some more unpredictable radio.
The Essential Selection. Friday nights on 1FM with Pete Tong.
504. Jim Bowen's TV show Bullseye may go to Sky TV in the autumn. It may not. Too many fashion models look anorexic, says a so-called expert today. And under the special tax concessions, the Queen won't have to fill out forms. This is radio's only postmodernist show, Steve Wright in the afternoon on 1FM from the BBC. Yay! Julie Burchill is with us. Mentioned earlier on about your stuff in the mail on Sunday. Do you really enjoy doing that? It seems to me. I mean, I do. I read your stuff frequently in various magazines, and you do seem to enjoy writing. You love. You've got a wonderful turn of phrase, and use of words is just staggering, really. I read somewhere, and I'm not just schmoozing you here. I read somebody said something about you, like, I've been to Cambridge, I've been to Oxford, I've been to Harvard, and she's cleverer than the lot of them.
Yeah, that was my best friend, though.
That's really high praise. Can you live with that?
I think I can live with it quite easily, yeah, because it's basically, like, I felt that way since I was 12, and, like, the amount of, like, anger and horror to find that people around me didn't share my opinion on myself was what truly made my teenage life unbearable.
Don't you think that there's too much expectation on you?
Nah, not really.
Because, you have to come up with something every week that's got to top last week's.
Yeah, but you have to come up with something every day, don't you?
Well,
I mean,
true,
I find it very easy once you get into it. It's easy, like, very easy.
Okay. So listen, let me just go back to No Exit, because we haven't actually spoken about it, and I guess the idea of you coming in would be to kind of mention it in passing.
Slightly, yes.
And I've got somebody from the publishers out there kind of, you know, looking really grim at the moment. So we'll mention it now, all right? Is that okay? So tell us why we should buy this book.
Well, because it's already in reprint and it doesn't officially come out until tomorrow, so it's obviously very good.
Yeah.
And it's a very, very good read. It will give you both excitement and exhilaration reading all the sex bits, and it will fill you in on what's happening in Czechoslovakia, which is a very solemn and awful thing.
His dark, glossy hair rose in a full, smooth quiff.
Well, that was just you, Steve.
Like an American retro ad dream from a bulging baby's brow. His glossy black brows and lashes were of the quality and quantity that supermodels spent hours in salons achieving by means of dye and tattoo. His nose was even shorter.
It is.
His nose was even shorter than his temper and a good deal straighter than his nature. Brilliant.
That is, do you think, brilliant. I could get a job writing press handouts for Take That?
Or for us. So listen, good luck with it, and I'm sure it'll sell well. Your other one did really well. In fact, you made over 100 grand on that.
I was very, very pleased.
Yeah. What are you going to do with all the money you've made,
I've spent it already.
You haven't?
Down the pub.
Really? I mean, are you investing? I mean, have you
become... No, I'm not investing.
Have you become, Julie, an out-and-out capitalist
No,
now?
Certainly not. I have as little money now as when I was taking the bottles back.
Yes. You know, when people get rich, they always give answers like that, don't they?
Oh, no.
Anyway, listen, thank you very much for coming in. I didn't think you'd come in, actually. I really didn't think you'd be by, as they say.
It's been very enjoyable.
Was it okay for you?
It's been fantastic.
It was okay for me.
Okay for you?
Fantastic. Oh, yes. All right, Julie Burchill, thank you very much,
thank
Julie.
Thank you. Yay!